Welcome back. We'll be covering one of the major topics for current affairs this time, and that's the Ockhi cyclone that recently struck the coast of India. Now, this Ockhi cyclone is derived from a Bangladesh name, and this word itself means eye. And when we talk about the tropical cyclones, we have the eye of the cyclone, that is the focus area, and across the eye you have the cyclonic conditions that are formed. Now, these cyclones, this cyclone is a tropical cyclone. There are two types of cyclones that we usually talk about, the temperate and the tropical cyclone. In this class, we would be focusing on a basic idea of tropical cyclone and then the naming of tropical cyclone in the Indian Ocean. This has been important because this was one of the major articles from Hindu this time. Now, coming on to tropical cyclone, it's basically a low pressure area that's formed, and you have the wind pattern that circulates, as we have seen, and it is anti-clockwise in the north hemisphere, clockwise in the southern hemisphere. Now, there are some preconditions required for the formation of the tropical cyclone. First is a warm, moist air source with a temperature of around 27 degrees Celsius. Then you have formation of storm clouds due to low wind shear, Coriolis force, which accentuates the process. So all these affect the formation of the tropical cyclone. Now, IMD, or Indian Meteorological Department, has classified 7 categories. If the wind speed is less than 17 knots, we say it's a low depression area. A wind speed of 28 to 33 knots is considered a deep depression, and above 34 knots we say it's a cyclonic condition or a cyclonic storm. So what basically happens is, when we start naming the cyclones, we start naming them only after the wind speed reaches 34 knots. So not prior to 34 knots, we do not name the tropical cyclones in the Indian Ocean. We name it once they attain the stage of cyclonic storm, and then you have severe cyclonic, very severe cyclonic, and super cyclonic. So this Ockhi cyclone was initially considered as a severe cyclonic storm, which was the alert level was increased to very severe and later on further decreased to severe. So that's the way it worked. Now, if we talk about some of the general picture of cyclonic conditions in India, we say that these natural disasters cause a loss of around 2% for the India's GDP and 12% of the central government's revenue. 10% of the world population, world's tropical cyclone occur in the states of India, which affect nearly 13 states and union territories and 84 coastal districts. Now, coming on to the most affected areas on the east coast, it's Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Tamil Nadu and West Bengal, and the union territory of Pondicherry. On the west coast, you have the state of Gujarat. The primary peak occurs in the month of November, and then you have a secondary peak that occurs in the month of May. So maximum cyclonic activity, or the most major peak that occurs, is in the month of November. Now, this diagram helps you understand the various cyclonic conditions. Now, this is the boundary of India, and you can see most of the cyclonic conditions occur towards the eastern coast, and then you have the various lines or the paths that denote the various cyclonic activities during the month of October-November. So during the month of October-November, all the yellow lines that could be seen are the regions of cyclonic activities. Then you have smaller intent, these signs, towards the month of July and September. So these are some of the major areas which are affected by cyclonic conditions during the various periods. Now, if you talk about a historical idea, it started with 1864. India witnessed two severe cyclones, one in Kolkata and another in Machilipatnam. Now, what happened during that time was, in 1865, Kolkata became the first port to have a storm warning system. Later on, this was incorporated in many ports and nearly extended to all ports in 1886. You have storm warning centers which were later on established in Visakhapatnam, in Ahmedabad. In 1969, you had Cyclone Distress Mitigation Committee, which came up for Andhra Pradesh and later on was expanded to Odisha and West Bengal. Now, if you talk about the Cyclone Warning Center, you have the DDGM at New Delhi. You have the weather forecasting at Pune. The area cyclone warning stations at Ahmedabad, Bhubaneswar and Vishakhapatnam, and the cyclone warning centers at Mumbai, Chennai and Kolkata. So those are the major centers in India. Now coming on to the next important topic, as we said, this is important because this was part of Hindu section, and you have the naming of the cyclones. Now naming of a cyclone is an interesting phenomena. If we talk about Pacific Ocean, the naming is done based on the alphabetical order. So you have A to Z as the naming. Now again in this A to Z naming, you have alternate male and female names that are taken up. Initially these were the names of persons, later on flowers, animals, trees, birds were included in the names. Now the naming started after World War II, and nearly all regions across the world now have the naming system. Later on in 2000, you had the World Meteorological Organization and United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and Pacific that gave the cyclone naming system for the tropical areas, specifically the Indian areas. And the cyclones worldwide were divided into 9 areas, 9 distinct zones. So you had the Atlantic, the North Atlantic, the Northeast Pacific, Central North Pacific, West North Pacific, North Indian Ocean. So that is what we would be discussing today, the North Indian Ocean. Then you have the Southwest Indian Ocean, Australian, South Pacific and South Atlantic. So these were the areas under which the cyclones were classified. Coming up to the North Indian Ocean, you have the names that first started in 2004, and the first cyclone was named as Onil, which was the name given by Bangladesh. Now there are 8 countries that provide the name in the North Indian Ocean. So it's Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Myanmar, Oman, Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Thailand. So name of the countries are important. There could be a direct MCQ, which of the countries is not the part of the naming system of tropical cyclone in the North Indian Ocean. So you have these 8 countries. Now what happens is the names are picked one by one. So let's say you have Ockhi, that was the name this time. Before Ockhi, you had the Thailand name, that was Mora, and the next cyclone that would come would be named as Sagar. So that's the sequence that you go on for. So it started from here. So it started from Agni from India, Onil, and then Agni from India, and so on. So the sequence clearly goes from Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Myanmar, Oman, Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Thailand. So these are the nations which are following the names, or the names from these nations are followed in this order based on the order of the country. Now again the interesting thing is, let's say this year the cyclones end at Luban in 2017. So next time whenever the cyclone comes in 2018, it would start here itself, that's at Titli. So those are the names given based on this category. Now Mora was the cyclone that was named from Thailand, and the word Mora means healing stones or the star of the sea. And the next cyclone that we said is the name of Sagar, that's an Indian name, so you are well acquainted with that. Now coming on to the Ockhi cyclone, as we said, this was a modification of the tropical cyclone Kiroki that worked over the regions of Thailand and finally drifted west, but it was unable to organize itself. So it started or developed deep near the Sri Lankan coast. However, with the proximity of the land, the strength was not gained so far, or was not so severe as it could be, and it was initially classified as tropical cyclone 03B. However, IMD upgraded it to deep depression, later on to cyclonic storm Ockhi, which was later on, as we said, converted to very severe and back to severe. So you have the sea surface temperature that was around 31 degrees Celsius that was realized, and there were various satellite imageries that were constantly working on this. So you have a kind of intact warning system that works on it. So there are various categories which are given for the warning systems. Now joint typhoon warning system, which is known as JTWC, is a US Department of Defense program or an agency that works on. And of these classifications, JTWC and IMD classifications are most important for you to remember. Now the speed is different under the Beaufort scale, and they are named by different names under the different classifications. So each of which named under which department is important. So JTWC is for Northwest Pacific, IMD for North Indian Ocean, you have MF for Southwest Indian Ocean, and so on and so forth. So let's say if we talk about IMD classification, up to a Beaufort scale of 0 to 7, we call it depression. Then up to 8 Beaufort scale, we call it deep depression, and so on. So this table is very, very important for you to remember. The next is the implications of cyclone. So cyclone brings out numerous destruction. Besides that, there are some benefits that are accentuated. So if we talk about the destruction, it's a strong wind, squall, you have torrential rainfall, inland flooding that is seen, destruction of the coastal areas, shipping and fishing industry that is damaged, and finally storm surge, that is an abnormal rise in the sea level. Again, some of the benefits include temporary relief from the drought conditions. It carries away the heat, so maintains a kind of stable warm temperature conditions for a prolonged period of time. The next is management. Now, management of cyclone can be divided under structural management and non-structural management. So structural management talks about constructions. So constructing cyclonic shelters, constructing rivers, roads, resistant buildings, bridges, canals, so on and so forth. Constructing tanks, communication networks, power transmission systems. If we talk about non-structural, it's basically the warning dissemination systems, the management of the coastal areas, awareness among people, early evacuation, and capacity building of the stakeholders. So those are some of the non-structural factors involved with the management. Now we would also focus on the NDMA classification in a separate class. So NDMA provides various analysis for the various natural disasters. So those would be covered separately. Now some of the important focus areas in news for the week 49 were net neutrality. You had the surface to air missile Akash. Then who are Kapu? That is important. So Kapu reservation bill was passed. You have Chandrayaan 2, that was in news. Important question for your subjective answers is, define the various categories of membership of IMO. What is IMO? Chhabar port was recently in news, is important, and the Ockhi cyclone that we have already talked about and covered. Some of the important lectures that we will be covering in the upcoming lectures are NDMA guidelines, as we already said, Bharatmala Pariyojana, Insolvency Bankruptcy Code, you have Urban Waste Management and International Court of Justice and the elections for the same. So with this, we cover our class on the Ockhi cyclone. We'll be covering another class on urban transportation policy, as we talked about in the previous session. So those two would be the GS class for this week. Stay tuned. Have a very good day ahead.